1987, 22-year-old Eileen Twain's professional music career looked like it was over before it barely started. She'd been performing since the age of eight in rundown country bars, talent shows, and rock clubs. But the tragic accident that killed her parents stopped everything cold in its tracks. She put whatever dreams she had on hold and got down to the business of making a life for her younger sister and brothers.
Eileen just came and, you know, again, was the rock. And I think we all just realized that there wasn't any other choice.
I took on the responsibility of my parents' estate. And just all of their affairs, which is a complete nightmare.
But Eileen persevered. She sold off her father's tools and battered pickup truck, and then turned to an old friend of her mother's for advice, a country singer named Mary Bailey, who was trying to make it as a talent manager.
When my parents died, and I was really thinking of just quitting music as a profession, Mary said, you know, knowing that it's something my mother would never have wanted.
Mary persuaded Eileen not to give up. She pulled some strings and got Eileen a steady gig at Deerhurst, a resort hotel in Huntsville, Ontario, that featured a Las Vegas-style review. The job meant Eileen could get her career back on track and maybe make just enough money to provide for her sister and brothers. She sold the family house, packed up what little they had, and moved the family south to Huntsville.
But at first, you know, we lived in a house that didn't have running water.
We went down to the river, we did our laundry in the river. And we bathed in the river. We just shampoo up, soap up, and jump in. And that was it.
At the Deerhurst Resort, Eileen rehearsed during the day and performed six nights a week for just enough money to get by. Although the pay was slim, the experience she was gaining was priceless.
It was like going to school in a way because like I said, I did have to learn how to move quickly in high-heel shoes and learn a little bit of choreography, and I wasn't good at it. I mean, I never learned how to dance or anything like that, so the girls there were very patient with me, and they would teach me, you know, the simplest routines, the ones that they thought I could handle.
Of course, she also sang in the bar. I think it was sort of called the disco bar at that time. So she would do the show, the Vegas show, and then go into the bar and sing.
26-year-old Eileen Twain was at a crossroads, both in her life and in her music. Her sister and brothers had finished school and were ready to go out on their own. She had been singing Vegas-style show tunes and rock, and she really loved was the country music of her youth and the new country-flavored songs she was writing in her spare hours. The time was right to take a shot at a real career.
When she felt that she was ready, she called me again and said, you know, Mare, that it's country music that I do want. It's what I do the best. It's where my heart really is.
There and then, Mary became Eileen's manager. Mary's first call was to an old acquaintance, Nashville entertainment lawyer Dick Frank. He agreed to take a look at Mary's new client and made the trip to Canada.
We were sitting at the table and all of a sudden a voice came out, and she wasn't at the stage. She came from the back of the room in a beautiful gown. And
you could have heard a pin drop. She owned the house before she opened her mouth. Been fortunate to know and work with a number of great talents. She is as great or greater than any talent I've known.
Immediately convinced of her innate star power, Dick Frank put the wheels in motion the minute he got back to Nashville. The first order of business was to record a three-song demo tape.
Well, Dick called me up and said that he had met a young lady up in Canada, and he said, I really believe that this girl is just a great singer, and would you be interested in helping out? And I said, well, yeah, sure.
Noro came into my office one day with a cassette of a demo that he had done. He said, here, stick this in, listen to it, and tell me what you think. And it was a demo he had done on Eileen Twain. You know, did it for $1,500 or something.
Buddy Cannon then played the tape for his boss, Mercury Records president Harold Shedd. the Nashville star maker, who a few years earlier had discovered and built Alabama into a country music powerhouse.
Harold struck himself on the chest and said, "I want her."
Eileen signed a contract with Mercury Records in late 1991. Although the deal happened quickly, the release of her first album would be a tedious and frustrating experience.
Going and sitting in the office with Harold and Steve Miller and saying, "Okay, now this is my artist, and we'll sign this deal, and we want her out, like, right away." And they said, "Well, I'm sorry, it's going to take, you know, 12 to 18 months. Oh, this is unacceptable."
The first bone of contention for the newly signed artist was a name change. Mercury insisted that Eileen was not the kind of name that sold records.
They said, "Right, you know, Eileen Twain isn't going to cut it as an artist. So you've got to choose a new name." The one thing she was never prepared to give up was Twain.
And I kind of felt my last name was cool, Twain. You know, I thought it was unusual. And since my father had died, I was kind of emotional about dropping it, too. I didn't really want to change it.
Eileen stuck to her guns about Twain and then came up with a new first name, Shania, the name of an Ojibwe seamstress she had worked with back in Deerhurst. She was now Shania Twain. She had come to Nashville with a heart full of dreams and a suitcase full of songs to record. But Shania quickly found out that's not the way it worked in Nashville. New artists seldom, if ever, get to record their own material.
She didn't really want to sing other songs. You know, she wanted to sing her own.
We didn't feel that her songs were developed enough.
We were doing what we thought was right as far as choosing songs for her.
It was heartbreaking. It was a real struggle. We were under the assumption, I guess if that would be the proper word, that we would get with writers and write the album and perfect some of the songs she did and put more songs on the album, and that did not come to pass.
When Shania's self-titled debut album was released in the spring of 1993, there was only one of Shania's songs on it, and even that was co-written. The first single would struggle to make it to number 55 on the country charts. Hardly an auspicious start, but the music video was a definite eye-opener.
Maybe tonight I'm gonna tell him we're not alone.
That's where it all began. It was open midriff. I don't know if I was the first one to do it. I didn't even know then that I was one of the first, or maybe the first to do it. I didn't realize.
But we didn't know the rules, you know? We didn't know you couldn't put a navel in a video. We didn't, you know, we just didn't know any better.
Even though the sensuality projected by Shania was innocent and flirty, when the video was presented to video programmers, they were less than enthusiastic.
Absolutely, there was resistance at CMT. You know, when you try to make changes, you want to make no mistake, you're up against resistance, and serious resistance.
She was being treated as almost like an alien. People didn't know how to react to her, that they were kind of looking at her from arm's length and just deciding what to make of this strange new creature that had hit in Nashville.